Hello and welcome to City Point Online Livestream. We're so glad that you could join us today. You're in for a treat. We're continuing our sermon series, Word Power, as we look through the Gospel of John and the message that Jesus had for his disciples and his followers, and even for us today. We're in a really good part. It's the Last Supper. We're nearing the end, and Jesus has a special word for his disciples. But before that, we're going to worship together. So turn up your volume and let's sing.
I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures of fate are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together. And every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Lord, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. Lord, there's nothing, nothing is better than you. I know it's true. Now I'll not atmosphere is changing now. For the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord is here. The atmosphere is changing.
Come.
To worship together as a church family. Hey, we're going to take a quick break, grab some coffee, maybe some paper to take notes, say hi down in the chat below, and don't forget to register for Pop-Up Church. It's going to be later on today. If you're watching this on the 21st, you still time to register. Be up with us on Mount Sequoia at 2:30, citypointchurch.tv/pop-up. And while you're taking care of all that, I want to know, what's your favorite movie? We'll be back in three.
Hey, I'm so glad you're here. Glad you're here. In John's Gospel, the 16th chapter, Jesus is going to be giving his last spoken words directly to his disciples while they're still in the upper room for the Passover meal, their last supper together. Now, John will have Jesus' prayer in chapter 17 that I think still happened while they were in the upper room together, because it's then that they leave and go to the garden and then Jesus is arrested. So chapter 16 is revealing one of those qualities of Jesus that we find so magnetic. Just pulls us into him. Look, his followers lack understanding. Jesus' followers are about to experience confusion and fear and abandonment and rejection, grief, loneliness. So what's he going to say? Well, not surprisingly, his words deal directly with comfort. But before I get into that, let me say this. I think it's rather obvious how the armies of evil are attempting to reframe questions for us to deal with in an effort to deceive us as to God's true nature. In fact, I think one of the most untrue and unbiblical questions that the evil forces want us to deal with above everything else is, how could a loving God send a person to hell? But that question is pushing a false narrative about God and his actions. The question is not how God could send, a loving God could send us to hell. The accurate question is, how could a holy, perfect God allow people like us to heaven? Because we are not holy and we are not perfect. We're sinful, and we know sin doesn't exist with a sinless God. That's the question we need to be dealing with. What did this loving God do to make forgiveness of sins a reality? That's the right question, because it doesn't frame this God of love as a tyrant that is sending souls to hell. That's not true. The truth is that Jesus reveals a God that longs for his creation, a God so loving that he chose to kill a part of himself so that human beings already condemned and moving toward hell might be rescued. Jesus started speaking these words of comfort earlier in their evening in the upper room together. The first time we start really seeing it is in chapter 14. Look at verse 16. I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever, for he lives with you and will be in you. The main reason and desire Jesus has in asking the Father to send us the Holy Spirit is intimacy. God has never wanted to send anyone to any kind of eternal separation. That's a misleading deception. God has always and only wanted to bring his creation back into fellowship and community, to restore those walks in the cool of the eve in the garden of paradise. And so Jesus' words of comfort would include his intention to give to all who will accept it his very own Spirit to live inside of us, first and foremost for the purpose of intimacy. You guys, the devil and his minions don't want anyone to know that God desires to be known, that a relationship with God is having a relationship with a being that is superior in every way to everyone. It's the best relationship ever. So the main purpose behind Jesus giving the Holy Spirit is that that relationship can be restored. Another function of the gift of Jesus' Spirit is the comfort found in his presence as a teacher. Look at John 14:26. The advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. There is so much comfort in having a teacher right here. and having a teacher nearby, someone to redirect and remind me of what is important and what is priority and what I need to be thinking about and pursuing. You know, before Siri, it was much more difficult to find answers, wasn't it? Siri, I got a question here. Especially for a young preacher, I worked with a guy, I've mentored under him for over 20 years, and he was a walking encyclopedia. And there were times I said, man, where is that passage that talks about it's good for two to be together, but a threefold cord is not quickly broken? Oh, that's Ecclesiastes. He'd just whip it right off. If ever I had a reference, what about that time the woman in Revelation? Oh, that's Revelation 12. He just knew. And man, it was great to prepare a sermon with him just sitting across the room. We shared an office together. And where's this passage? Where's that? I remember one time when some dear friends of ours went through a tragedy of tragedies. They had a child that lived only 31 days. And they wanted me to do the funeral. Well, I hadn't been in the ministry long. What am I was crying as hard as they were. I didn't know what to say. I can remember going to him, that teacher that God had given me, and said, what do I say? And he said, well, you've got some real strong Bible passages. And I remember asking him, where does this talk about this? And he said, well, you know, you remember David and Bathsheba in there? And the only thing I thought about David and Bathsheba was adultery. And I didn't even know that passage existed about David saying, the baby can't come back to me now that it has died, but I can return to that baby. There is just so much comfort in the ever-abiding presence of a great teacher. Well, Jesus has given you His very Spirit. What a comfort that is. And Jesus has already made the reference to the Spirit producing fruit. We just touched on that briefly from chapter 15. The Spirit is at work in us, producing powerful changes for the betterment of our community and our world and our families, all the time living and working through us. And nothing is short of extraordinary in what the Spirit of God can do and can produce in a person. A missionary in Africa told the story of an elderly woman who was reached with the gospel of Christ. She was blind and illiterate, but she so wanted to share her newfound faith with others. She prayed and prayed and prayed about it, and she got something from the Spirit. So she went to the missionary who led her to Christ, and she said, do you have a copy of the Bible in French? And he said, well, yes. And she said, may I have it? And he said, well, certainly. And he couldn't understand why she wanted it. She couldn't read and write. And she said, would you mark it to where it's opened to John 3:16 that you taught me? And he said, well, certainly. And she said, well, would you underline that verse right there in John 3:16? And he said, well, okay. You know, she's blind and she's illiterate. But he did what she did, wanted, and she walked out with her Bible. Days passed, and you know, the missionary is really curious. What in the world is she doing? Well, he found out that she was waiting at the school in the afternoons. And he had to see this for himself. So he went and he spied on her. He watched her from a distance. And you know what she was doing? She would get to the front door of the school. And as soon as school let out and the boys all started coming out, she would say, sir, do you speak French? And one of the young boys would say, yes, I do. She said, would you help me with this? Would you read this for me? Well, of course, he could see that she was blind, and she would open right up to him. And she said, it's the part that's underlined right there. And so he would go ahead and read, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten. He'd go through the whole thing. And after he would read that, she would ask him, do you know what that means? And so many of those boys would say, no, I don't know. And she would tell him what it means. Do you know she did this day after day, month after month, year after year? This missionary was telling this story, said that so many people were brought to Christ. In fact, to the count that he had at that time, 24 of those young boys were serving as pastors in different places. Y'all, if the Spirit of God can breathe on dirt and it will become a living soul, What in the world can the Spirit of God produce through a blind, illiterate woman with a bunch of schoolboys? What a comfort to have someone so powerful in us producing the works of God through us. I love this. And then in chapter 16, we're there now. Jesus gives his disciples the comfort of two more specific functions of the Holy Spirit. Start in verse 7. But very truly I tell you, it is for your good that I'm going away. Unless I go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. When he comes, he will convict the world of guilt in regard to sin and righteousness and judgment. Is it a comfort to you to know that you are not responsible for the convicting of the world of sin, righteousness, and judgment? I got to tell you, that's a comfort to me. It is not our responsibility. It's the responsibility of the Holy Spirit in us. Now, that might sound somatic, but I think this is important. Our responsibility is to listen to the Spirit and to follow the Spirit's lead. It's not to manufacture something and figure it out on our own. That's why Jesus gave us the Spirit. The biblical scholar N.T. Wright talks about an archbishop who told the story of three hardened teenagers who one day for a laugh went to the confessional booth at the local Catholic church. And they all confessed to a long list of ridiculous and grievous sins that they had not committed. It was a lousy prank, but they did it. The priest saw through their thoughtless joke, and he played along with the first two, who ended up running out of the church laughing. But the priest, for some reason, was prompted with this third prankster to hold on to him. And after he finished his absurd confession, the priest said, "Okay, you've confessed these sins. Now I want you to do something to show your repentance. I want you to walk up to the far end of the church, up at the front there, and I want you to look at that picture of Jesus hanging on the cross. And I want you to look at his face, and I want you to say, 'You did all that for me, and I don't care that much.' And I want you to say that three times." So the boy really couldn't escape. The other two were gone, but it was just him and the priest. The priest came out of the booth and he watched him walk up there. The boy walked up there and he looked at the picture of Jesus and he said, "You did all that for me and I don't care that much. You did all that for me and I don't care that much." Well, he couldn't say it the third time because he broke down in tears. The archbishop telling that story said, "The reason I know that story is because I was that young man." I don't think that archbishop was the one that figured out the perfect scenario to bring conviction to that young man, the priest, rather. I don't think he's the one responsible for that. I think this proving or convicting the world of sin and righteousness and judgment, Jesus is telling us, this is in the hands of the Holy Spirit. It's his responsibility. It's ours to obey and to follow. There's just a lot of comfort in knowing who is in charge and who is to obey. Who is to lead and who is to follow. It is the Holy Spirit's to convict. And Jesus offers an additional comfort in the function of the Holy Spirit in verse 13. "When he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth." The Spirit is the guide. Not another person. Not another organization. Not another nation or kingdom. Not some religion. The indwelling Holy Spirit in the individual is to be the guide in discovering truth. And while we are on earth, truth is just that. It's an ongoing, ever-pursuing discovery. Listen, truth is absolute, most definitely. But finding it and understanding it is a lifelong process. Before Jesus gave these words of comfort, he prefaced this gift of the Holy Spirit with these words. Look what it says in verse 6 of chapter 14. I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus is the absolute truth, and he has assumed the responsibility in guiding us to himself. Man, the pressure is off. We just keep our eyes focused on him and listen to his indwelling spirit. All of these words have been spoken for the followers' peace and comfort. And then finally, we come to the last verse of chapter 16. John gives us Jesus' final sentences to his followers that evening in the upper room. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have trouble, but take heart, I've overcome the world. Jesus equals peace. The world equals trouble. Jesus is greater than the world and trouble. And since Jesus has overcome this world and its trouble, then any turbulence that we go through here on earth is never really as big and as damaging as we think it is. Patrick Smith is a commercial airline pilot, and he flies 757s and 767s. He admits that flight turbulence is the number one concern of anxious passengers. No surprise. But he tries to assure us that turbulence seems and appears much more than it actually is. He writes this: for all intents and purposes, a plane cannot be flipped upside down, thrown into a tailspin, or otherwise flung from the sky by even the mightiest gust or air pocket. Conditions might be annoying and uncomfortable, but the plane is not going to crash. Turbulence is an aggravating nuisance for everybody, including the crew, but it's also, for lack of a better term, normal. From a pilot's perspective, he writes, it is ordinarily seen as a convenience issue, not a safety issue. When a flight changes altitude in search of smoother conditions, this is by large in the interest of comfort. The pilots aren't worried about the wings falling off. They're trying to keep their customers relaxed and everybody's coffee where it belongs. In the worst of it, you probably imagine the pilots in a sweaty lather, the captain barking orders, hands tied on the wheel as the ship lists from one side to the other. He says nothing could be further from the truth. Actually, he concludes, while the passengers are fretting about turbulence, the pilots are having a casual conversation about their morning orange juice. Truth? Hey, when oceans rise and mountains fall into the sea, that's a big deal for us. But to Jesus, minor turbulence. Physical sickness and death, that's an issue for us. To Jesus, minor turbulence. I mean, things like failure and fear and heartache and pain and shame, those weigh heavy with us. To Jesus, minor turbulence. Why? Because of all of these things and a gazillion more just like them, they're all of the world. And Jesus, in words of comfort, said this as the last thing to his disciples. Take heart. I've overcome the world.
There is a light. It burns brighter than the sun. He steals the night and casts no shadow. There is hope. Should oceans rise and mountains fall, He never fails. So take heart, let His love lead us through the night. Hold on to hope and take courage again. Death by love, the fallen world was overcome. He wears the scars of our freedom in His name. All our fears are swept away, He never fails. So take heart, let His love lead us through the night. Hold on to hope and take courage again. Troubles, take heart, for He has overcome. All the world and its troubles, take heart, for our God has overcome. All the world and its troubles, take heart, for He has overcome. All the world and its troubles, take heart, for our God has overcome. All the world and its troubles, take heart, for He has overcome. All the world and its troubles, take heart, for our God has overcome. All the world and its troubles, take heart, for He has overcome. All the world and its troubles, take heart, for our God has
May the Lord Jesus give us His perspective on the troubles we face in this life. And may we focus more on what He has overcome than on the troubles we face. Amen, amen. Have a great week.
Whatever comes, I
faithfulness, my solid rock. I give thanks for all you have done, and I will sing of your mercy and your love. Your love is unfailing, Lord, I am grateful. I give thanks for all you have done. I won't forget all the battles you have won. Your love is unfailing, Lord, I am grateful. And as we lift our hands, the heavens open, heavens open. So let our lives declare the love our God has spoken over us. And as we lift our hands, the heavens open, heavens open. For all you have done, and I will.